I will try to go less on the theory part of the high frequency, more on the practical part of the high frequency ventilation. Why do we need the major indication is as a rescue ventilation when we fail on the conventional ventilation. Dr. Yaya said he uses as a primary mode. So some of the people are using as a primary mode, but I think Cochrane doesn't say this and as a primary mode, yes. But if you should have a very low threshold to change to a high frequency ventilator ventilation, especially if you have a very bad ARDS, because you will be the lungs will be protected. You will give them less volume trauma and PIE and then BPD. And again, more to avoid barotrauma. And again, as I said, primary mode in VLPW, we are not sure. So people have different opinions. And it is defined by FDA that any ventilator which is delivering more than 150 breaths per minute is a high frequency ventilator. And the beauty is that it delivers a small tidal volume, usually less than or equal to anatomical dead space. And these are classified by their exhalation mechanism, whether exhalation mechanism is active or it is passive. So if the exhalation mechanism is active, it is HFOV, high frequency oscillator ventilator. If the exhalation mechanism is passive, then it is a JET or HFPPV, which we used to use a high frequency positive pressure ventilation when we didn't have a high frequency ventilator. We were using during my training period in my MD, and HFI. So why do we talked about the pressure volume loop, and we talked about the various traumas, and we know that where is the safe zone window when we will have less injuries. So if we are recruiting, de-recruitment area, atelectatic area where a lot of pressure is required to and will change only small volume, FRC is less, or if you have gone too high over distension area where again too much pressure when you will change and very little volume will be changed. Both these areas are area of zones of injuries, and we want to ventilate our babies into this safe zone, which is called a safe window. Now, to ventilate our babies in the safe window, you will be causing less pressure and the volume swings. This is the idea. So when you are ventilating a baby on a CMV mode, there are swings between the zones of injury from inspiration to expiration. When you are, so this is inspiration time when you can have injury, and then this is expiratory time when you can have injuries. When you are having a high frequency oscillator ventilator, I will be talking on HFOV because that's what I use. The entire cycle operates in the safe window zone, you can see here, and hence it avoids the injury zones, both the lower as well as the upper zones it avoids. This is the reason why we are using the high frequency ventilator. Now, if you see the airway pressure waveform of high frequency at the ventilator end, and then when it goes down to the airway, and then when it reaches the alveoli, this is how it is at the ventilator end. Then if the airway is like this, and by the time it reaches the alveoli, it is very smooth and small airway pressure waveforms. In conventional, at the ventilator, it is like this. Hardly there is a change till it reaches the alveoli. So that's the reason that the CMV, the pressure exerted by the ventilator, propagate through the airway with little dampening. Dampening doesn't happen. And with HFOV, there is attenuation of the pressure as air moves towards the alveolar level. Thus, with the CMV, the alveoli receives the full pressure from the ventilator. Whereas HFOV, there is a minimal stretching of the alveoli and therefore less risk of trauma. So what is the physiology of HFOV? So what we are doing is we are optimizing the FRC okay, and minimizing the cyclical stretch of the lungs. So you see here, sorry, so we are optimizing the FRC, okay, and then we are minimizing the this injury. So that's why, so we are optimizing FRC and minimizing the cyclical stretch of the lungs, and hence it maintains relatively high MAP and a low phasic volume and low pressure changes. This is it. So why we want to put a baby on HFOV? Because we want to oxygenate and ventilate the baby with an adequate lung volume while minimizing the barotrauma and not giving a oxygen toxicity. So my major concern is this oxygen toxicity. If I'm going higher on the FiO2, I don't want my babies to be having oxygen toxicity, because I know it's going to cause oxygen free radical injuries to the brain, to the eyes, to the lungs, to the intestine, everywhere. And hence, if my baby is going requiring a higher oxygen or requiring a higher pressure, I would go and switch to the HFOV. And people have given the indications of OI more than 15 to put the baby on the high frequency. Now, when I'm putting the baby on a high frequency ventilator strategies, there are two strategies, high volume strategy and a low volume strategy. I'm not going into all those details because time shortage, I just don't want to go. It's a big, it will take days if I want to finish the HFOV otherwise. But what I want to say is the studies which were done earlier on had failed and shown failure because they were all using low volume strategies. And we all have gone away from the low volume strategies and we go for a high volume strategies. Now, so the often forgotten is the optimizing lung inflation with MAP. So if you see A, area is under inflation. B is optimal inflation during inspiration. C is over inflation. And D is optimal inflation in weaning. So we want our babies with B and D. So in the, how to achieve in the high volume strategies, the optimal inflation is majorly we can see by the X-rays. Now, when we are doing a conventional ventilation without the X-ray also, you can see how much is the chest expansion and then how much is the rise of the chest. And so you can optimize your pressures just by looking at the baby's chest. Here also, you can actually look at the how much is the chest expansion by going on the side of the baby and looking at it. But finally, you will be able to know by your X-rays. So how do you measure is you will look at the top margin of the right dome of the diaphragm and it should be at around 9 rib. And lung aeration in the X-ray should look good. Overinflation will be when your top margin of the right dome of the diaphragm is at the 10th rib. And there is an intercostal bulging. And when would you say underinflation? When the top margin of the right dome of diaphragm is below 8th rib and the under-aerated lung fields are C. So this is how you will see. So this is a baby who is on high frequency. And if you will count the ribs, there are around 8. And so it's like 7.5. So you can go higher. But if you went too high, you are going to cause this pneumothorax to the baby. So this is like a over-inflated. That was like a under-inflated. So you have to have a normal inflated lungs. So usually the high-volume strategy is used as a lung recruitment strategy. And they are used only for preterm and term infants with RDS or surfactant inactivation due to any other factor like meconium aspiration syndrome or pulmonary hemorrhage. The lung recruitment might be harmful if you have a baby who has a hypoplastic lung, and if you have a baby with a CDH, you have to be very careful on them. And primary PPHN is not a problem with the lungs. It is a problem not with the lung alveoli as such. So in those babies, if you will go for a high volume strategies, you may be doing more harm. So this you have to be understanding what for you are using. Now, when we are using a high frequency ventilator, we are in the conventional mode of ventilation, we were using PIP, we are using PEEP, we are using inspiratory time, you are using expiratory time, you are putting rate, and you are looking at the map. Now, and then you are setting an FiO2. Now, in a high frequency ventilator, what you are going to do is, you are going to set only few things. One is frequency, second is amplitude, third is your MAP, and fourth is your FiO2. So how do we do it? That we will see one by one. Range of the high frequency is between 6 to 15. Now, optimal frequency of oscillation may be different in different disease states, that we must understand. If we have a very small babies, you will use a higher rates. In a term baby, you will use around 8 to 10, ELPW 15 and VLPW 12. Lower frequency 6 to 8 are used for babies with meconium aspiration syndrome with air trapping. It's used for babies who are ventilated for more than 2 weeks, where we know that the airway resistance is increased. Babies who have pulmonary hypoplasia or who has a very stiff lung, that is a time when we are going to use a lower frequency. Some people say, forget about this difference in frequency and just use 10 for all. But I do differ in for different babies. Now, the practical issues are when you are using a... The practical issues are you are using an amplitude and you are putting a frequency. So, you should know that whenever you are putting a... you are choosing any of these, if you have a small change in any of these, it may produce a large change in the CO2 elimination. And hence, you should have a monitoring of the PCO2, or you can have a transcutaneous or tracheal CO2 monitor. And you should avoid wide fluctuations in the PCO2 levels. Whenever you're doing ET suctions, you should increase the MAP by 2. Now, there could be troubleshooting during HFOV. Persisting hypotension may be there. If it is there, then give additional volume of 10 ml per kg of saline. Consider over-distension and reduce MAP and see the response. So we should be very, very careful when you are putting a baby on high frequency and you are over-inflating, that may be a problem and causing hypotension. So whenever you are putting a baby on a high frequency ventilator, don't go away from the baby. Stay there to see that if you have used a proper kind of a pressure. What if the baby is having a cystic new BPD? And if you are using a high frequency ventilator on these babies, you may actually worsen the lung injury. You may increase the size of the cyst and the secretions may cause atelectasis. There may be a transient improvement, but there will be a big loss. And so there may be a short-term gain, but long-term pain. So you have to be very careful in babies with cystic new BPD. What is new in the HFOV? Now, we were talking about CO2 problems, and small change in things might have a big change in the CO2. So new thing in the high frequency is volume guarantee. The new thing in high frequency is that you can give high frequency from the nose, that is non-invasive. We have a better monitoring during HFOV, and also there is another thing, approach is open lung approach. We will take them one by one. So HFOV came, and then HFOV with volume guarantee came, and we are seeing babies. our clinical strategy to have a baby with a achieved stable blood gases, a baby whom we can stabilize and recruit the alveoli and reduce the strain and stress. So again, approach of the HFOV, comparing HFOV and conventional, is inside the device. This is how conventional is, as I told earlier, and this is how HFOV. And as we reach the alveoli, dampening is happening in the HFOV. Now, in the preterm babies, when do we start giving HFOV? So as I said, some of them are using as a primary mode when you have a very bad severe ARDS. But mostly we are using as a rescue mode when we have severe RDS and we are failing on the conventional ventilator, when we have pulmonary hypoplasia, when there is an air leak syndrome, if you are suffering from recurrent pneumothorax or you have already getting a pulmonary interstitial emphysema. Other indications are congenital diaphragmatic hernia and meconium aspiration. So the initial setting would be whenever you are, because we are using as a rescue mode. So baby is already on a conventional mode of ventilator and he's on some MAP. So usually if you don't have a baby who has an air leak, you will be choosing a MAP 2 to 3 centimeters above the conventional ventilation. And then if you have a baby with an air leak, you will choose the same or a one MAP below the conventional ventilation. Amplitude, how do you choose? To begin with, you don't know what is going to happen. Wriggling you will see only when you put the baby on the ventilator. So 2 times the MAP you can choose to begin with the amplitude. And then you should look at the baby and look at the oscillations. The baby wriggling should be there. And the wriggling should not be below the umbilicus. If the wriggling is below the umbilicus, that means it is too much. And so you have to reduce the amplitude. And frequency, as I said, depends on the ELPW term baby. And if we have a very small baby, you may go for a 12 hertz, 12 to 15. If it is a medium baby, then 10 to 12. And if it is a term baby, 8 to 10. And I is to E ratio, you will keep 1:2. The advantage to use early on in preterm is that we will be able to recruit our baby's lungs well. And there will be a dramatic effect in infants whose primary pathophysiology is decreased lung inflation. And once we are able to open the lungs, then it is possible to maintain the lung inflation with lower distending pressure. So that open lung strategy, like you open the lung and then you can keep them open easily. And we will talk about it. This will improve ventilation at the lower pressure and volume swings in the lungs. It provides a more uniform lung inflation and hence it will reduce the air leak. This is the advantage. When do you use HFOV in PPHN? I have found it to be very, very useful. At the moment I find PPHN, I put the babies on HFOV. And especially if the PPHN is complicated by severe RDS, PPRM, pulmonary hypoplasia, it actually improves the lung inflation by improving the VQ match, improving the gas exchange and pulmonary vasodilatation. So whenever you are putting the baby on a HFOV, you have to monitor the baby closely, looking at the lung expansion. Clinically, as I said, stand there, look at the chest, how much is inflated, and then do the X-ray. Do a close monitoring of the blood gas. I always say, once I put a baby on the HFOV, after 1 hour, do an X-ray, do a blood gas. But till that 1 hour, you should be standing there looking at the chest, how much is the inflation of the chest clinically. And if you have, you should have a transcutaneous carbon dioxide monitoring. Monitor the blood pressure very closely. And important is to keep the clear airways. HFOV is very oscillation dependent. So if there is a secretion, it will not work well. The wiggle factor. So as I said, reassess after positional changes. If chest oscillation is diminished or absent, if it is not there, then you should see why it has happened. It may happen because there is a decreased pulmonary compliance, or there could be a disconnection of the ET2, or the ETT is obstructed, or it may happen when there is a severe bronchospasm. So you should look at that. If the chest oscillation has become unilateral, then it could be due to ET displacement. It has gone to the right side, or it could be due to the pneumothorax on that, on the side where wriggling is not happening. So we should be looking at the wiggling. It gives us a good clue what is happening to the baby. Then how do you select the amplitude? As I said, that we should select two times the map and then look at the wiggle, which should extend above the umbilicus. And just keep on adjusting if it is not happening and follow the wiggle. And then once you have set the amplitude, looking at the wiggle, then the amplitude has to be changed depending on your carbon dioxide, which may be a PaCO2 or TCO. So our goal, remember, is not to achieve a normal PCO2 and pH, but our main goal is to minimize the villi. The limitation is, if we have an airway disease or airway obstruction, it may worsen the air trapping. If we have a baby with a shock or hypertension, it may further decrease the venous return and poor cardiac output. So this you should be remembering. Now we will come to each parameter, what are they doing. So oscillation around a set mean airway pressure. Amplitude of oscillation will give the tidal volume of the oscillations, and then the oscillatory frequency, inspiratory to expiratory ratio, and the inspirator oxygen concentration. These are the parameters which we are going to look at, and what to do with them, that is what we need to see. So in the conventional ventilation, what we had seen, that the carbon dioxide and oxygen go hand in hand by the parameters. So if we have higher PCO2 and lower oxygenation in the conventional mode of ventilator, what we do, we increase the PIP, and that will help both. In the high frequency ventilation, to some extent, not completely, but to some extent, the oxygenation and the carbon dioxide, they are independently working from each other. So the influence on the oxygenation is by only two factors in a high frequency ventilation. One is the FiO2. If you are increasing the FiO2, your oxygenation is going to improve. The other is MAP. If you are increasing your MAP, your oxygenation is going to improve. So optimize the lung volume and thus the alveolar surface area for the gas exchange. Recruit the epilectic alveoli, that is how the MAP is going to help. And it prevents the alveoli from collapsing. So de-recruitment is not happening. Also, don't go too much to avoid over-distinction. So this is about the oxygenation. What about the carbon dioxide? So what is influencing the carbon dioxide in your high-frequency ventilation? So amplitude, oscillatory amplitude is major factor, and the other factor is your frequency. So the oscillatory amplitude, if you are increasing, it will increase the tidal volume, and hence the CO2 will be decreased. So we have baby log VN600 and VN800, which provides a direct adjustment of amplitude in the MBAR. The maximum oscillatory amplitude is strongly influenced by what? By your patient circuit, by the water level in the humidified chamber, by the frequency, and IS2E ratio. So you should look at all these factors when you are seeing the amplitude. And I already said, when you don't have a wiggling, your amplitude is missing, that means something is gone here wrong. Patient circuit may have gone, ET tube must have come out, there might be secretion or water in the thing. So all these factors, or as I said, if one side, the pneumothorax might have happened, tube might have got to one side, all these three factors are influencing your amplitude. So pressure is never ever ventilating a patient. It is just the moving force of the gas flow differently. And carbon dioxide can only be removed by alveolar gas exchange, and this can be done by a tidal volume. Now, how do we achieve this? If you look at conventional ventilation, the minute ventilation is equal to tidal volume into frequency. Here, we are not looking into minute ventilation, and this minute ventilation is telling how much is the carbon dioxide going to be affected in the conventional ventilation. In the high frequency oscillation, it is the DCO2 which we are seeing, and it depends on tidal volume square into frequency. So it is a tidal volume square into frequency. And hence, you can see the major difference between the conventional and the HFOV, that HFOV, the relation between carbon dioxide removal frequency and tidal volume is different. So it is tidal volume square frequency. So if you make a little change in the tidal volume, it's going to give a huge change in the DCO2 and huge change in the carbon dioxide removal. So if we are increasing the oscillator volume by increasing the amplitude and we are reducing the frequency, both of them are going to increase the DCO2, and by increasing DCO2, we are reducing the PCO2. And hence, to improve the carbon dioxide removal, you will increase the amplitude and you will see what happened to the tidal volume. And if this does not improve the carbon dioxide removal, then only you consider decreasing the frequency. So don't touch the frequency right away. I want to give example why everyone will think, oh, when I am increasing the rate, carbon dioxide should wash off. Why it is not washing off? Even if you look at the formula, then VT square, at least some effect is there if we increase in the frequency. So I should increase the frequency. So I will give you example, visual, to say why it doesn't happen. So if this is the time and we are using 4 hertz, I'm just giving one example because visually you will be able to see better. If we are giving 4 hertz and comparing with the 8 hertz, see what's happening. When we are giving 4 hertz and when you're giving 8 hertz, what the difference you can see? When you're giving 4 hertz, the volume displaced is quite more, and volume displaced has a square effect on the carbon dioxide. When you're giving 8 hertz, the volume displaced becomes very less. So if you're increasing the frequency, you are actually decreasing the volume displaced. So you are decreasing the tidal volume, and hence square of that will be reduced. And that's the reason lower frequencies would have a larger volume displacement and improve carbon dioxide elimination. I hope you understood this. Then we are saying that, and you must have seen, whenever you're putting a baby on a high frequency ventilator, you may have a washout of carbon dioxide very soon. So to overcome that, one, as I said, we should use a TCO2, a continuous carbon dioxide monitor, do a repeated blood gases, look at the rigel. But all these may not help, and we may get a help with a simple thing added, as we added in the conventional ventilator, volume guarantee. So when you use a volume guarantee in a conventional ventilator, as the volume is being achieved, your pressure is going changing. So pressure regulation is happening. When you add a volume guarantee to the high frequency ventilator, the volume is constant, and with the change in the volume, what is regulated is not MAP but amplitude here, because this is amplitude is the one which is going to be directly leading to the volume. So we will add a volume guarantee to our HFOV. So HFOV with volume guarantee, So HFO volume guarantee can compensate for change in resistance and compliance of the lung end circuit. The HFO volume guarantee can stabilize the ventilation and blood gases, and hence the potential to prevent uncontrolled hyperventilation, uncontrolled hypocarbia, and hence it will reduce the risk of PVL. This is very well available by Dräger, and they have made it as patent, and we are using them. I'm not actually promoting Dräger. I'm just giving the usefulness of volume guarantee. So we don't want hypocapnia to occur. So now, what are our goals of adjusting the map? Now, we already said that, okay, we will be keeping the map two above the conventional ventilation, but what are our goal of adjusting the map? What we want? We want a balance of lung recruitment versus the overinflation, because we don't want air leaks to happen. So we want our optimal ventilation on the pressure volume curve, so that we should have best oxygenation, point of best compliance, and lowest possible MAC to achieve this, so that the pulmonary blood flow should not be decreased. So we don't want this. We don't want this. We want to be here. How do we do that? So there is one lung recruitment manual strategy. I think this is not clear. We'll go here. This is more clear. So what we do that, we set a mean airway pressure at 6 to 8 centimeter of water and adjust the FiO2 to give saturation of 90 to 95, which may be 70, 80, whatever. And then we start increasing the MAP 1 to 2 centimeter every 2 to 3 minutes and reduce the FiO2 stepwise 0.05 to 0.1 to maintain the saturation of 90 to 95. This will give this. So we will be somewhere here. Okay, we don't want to be here. We have just found that where will be that point. And then we stop increasing the MAP when FiO2 is smaller than the 25%, or when FiO2 is not able to be decreased with the increase in the MAP. So we stop there. And then when we stop there, we stop decreasing MAP 1 to 2 every 2 to 3 minutes until saturation falls. So this is here. So here is the maximum where this over is started, and this is when the saturation has started falling, 0.4 and 0.2. And where do we keep now our baby? We recruit the lung again by returning to the known points, that was step 3 for 2-3 minutes, and then decrease MAP above the closing pressure from step 4. So we come here and then we go here. So we reach somewhere here. This is one way to do it. And the other way to do it, very simple, was to keep 2 above the conventional mode of ventilation, and then you
How many minutes more, Dr. Monica?
Just 5 to 10 minutes more.
Oh.
And then you do the x-rays and look at it. So when you use volume guarantee, it will reduce your if you look at the different studies, it has shown that when you use volume guarantee, you are going to be having a proper tidal volume and you will be preventing a overventilation. So these are the evidences which I wanted to show, where if you are using a volume guarantee, you will have more time of ventilation during the target tidal volume and less during under or over. And they have shown that the preterm infants with high frequency ventilator, which are combined with volume guarantee, they have reduced outcome of death or PPD or hypercapnia compared with those who are actually not being used on volume guarantee. So there was a pilot study which also showed that volume guarantee helped our small babies to prevent hypoxia and hypocapnia. So Dragger is the one which has started using this volume guarantee. So I'm just going to finish with this protocol, what one can use, that you will fix a tidal volume, which is 1 to 2 ml per kg for the high frequency ventilator. And you will fix a frequency, and you know that tidal volume square into frequency is causing the DCO2. And as we already know that if you're using the tidal volume, then the DCO2 is going to increase with the reduce of DCO2. If you add VG with this, then the tidal volume will remain constant and DCO2 will remain constant and PCO2 will remain constant. So the clinical studies have shown that when you are using this tidal volume, the carbon dioxide and DCO2 have remained constant. So you don't get hypocapnia and you don't get overventilated. So what is our target DCO2? So whenever you are putting a baby on a ventilator, you should know what is the target DCO2. We said DCO2 is frequency into tidal volume square. So usually it is 1 to 2 ml per kg. So depending on the weight, it will increase. So 1 kg baby, the tidal volume will be 2. So 2 into frequency. So you will have, and this depends on the frequency you are using. So it will be 60 for a 1 kg baby. For a 2 kg baby, it will be 240. For a 3 kg baby, 540. And for a 4 kg baby, 960. Because you will multiply it with the weight. So this is how, when you are setting a high frequency ventilator, you should see what DCO2 baby is getting and whether the baby is getting the DCO2 what it is desired. So we select the frequency of 12 to 13 for VLPW for term 8 to 10. Tidal volume we set 2 ml per kg, and DV max we set 30 to 40 centimeter of water to begin with, which is usually twice as max. And with the tidal volume, this amplitude will keep on changing depending on how's the compliance of the baby. Selecting of the MAP would be 2 above the current MAP. And I is to E ratio will be 1 is to 2. And then we will monitor the tidal volume, achieve DCO2. And also we will do blood gases and see. So the frequency, as I said, will depend on the baby. If it is a smaller baby, higher frequency, term baby, meconium, lower frequency. So this we have already set, and we have to set the lower limit and the upper limit as well for the volume. And the step 4 and 5 is that we should be looking at the mean airway pressure and mean intrapulmonary pressures, and setting the inspirated IS to 2 ratio as 1 is to 2, usually that is what we are keeping. And then we are looking at the baby's inflation by keeping the MAP. We will be monitoring the babies by looking at the heart rate, X-ray, saturations, transcutaneous oxygen, and urine output, and obviously we will be doing the blood gases. Troubleshoots, if you have hypoxia, what you should do, you should increase the FiO2, or you can increase the MAP if your lungs are underinflated, guided by the X-ray. If you have hyperoxia, decrease the FiO2, because we don't want hyperoxia. And also, if it is overinflated, then you will decrease the MAP. If not overinflated, please don't start decreasing the MAP. Decrease the MAP only when your FiO2 has come down below 30%. If you have hypocarbia, reduce the tidal volume by 0.1 to 0.2 ml per kg, and be mindful to remain within the range of tidal volume for frequency selected. So if you have selected 10, this should be the tidal volume. Don't go lower limit or above the limit of the tidal volume. So if you have hypercapnia, then check for the chest wiggle and evaluate for the dope. Consider reducing the MAP, because too much of MAP will also cause hypercarbia. If your set tidal volume is reached, then you can increase the tidal volume by 0.1 to 0.2. But if your set tidal volume was not reached, then you will increase your amplitude max so that you can wriggle more. And so you can increase the Dmax. If that's not the case, then you will reduce the frequency. So that this is frequency reduction to take care of the CO2 would be the last step by the by you. Extubation and the nursing care, time of weaning would depend on the lung disease, and usually 8 to 10 centimeter of water when you reach, you will try to wean. You don't need to wean the frequency. You don't need to wean the amplitude, because if you are using the volume guarantee mode. And we convert CMV before considering extubation. And while we are treating the babies on high frequency, you should give some fentanyl infusion, but we don't use paralysis. Suctioning should be done minimum, but done only if needed. And that also to be done in the online suction. When should you do suctioning? Routine suctioning should not be done. You have to do only when there is a decrease or absent wiggling or decreased saturation or transpiration. Cutaneous oxygen levels are there, or carbon dioxide has increased. As because if you do more suctioning unnecessarily, you will be de-recruiting the lung volume. And always suction should be done under a closed suction system. You may require a sustained inflation recruitment when you are following a suction. So the learning points are: MAP is based on the conventional ventilation mode, oxygen IS2 ratio, and you have to look at the X-ray. Frequency is specific to the lung disease, compliance, and gestation. Tidal volume is set lowest for the frequencies and adjusted accordingly. Set realistic amplitude to accommodate above settings. Keep IS2 ratio 1:2. And keep monitoring the DCO2 amplitude trends, take transcutaneous CO2, SATs, gas, and X-ray. Real-time responses to changes should be seen, and you should tell why you have changed. Thank you. This was one case where baby's lungs had improved. Thank you, and open for question.
Thank you very much, Dr. Monica. I have one question from Dr. Amr Abilal. What's the relation or the difference